nothing perfect or considerable. We're so damn good. It's the story of your life. You're moving.
Good morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt on this Friday morning. Doing my best not to cry for the Ukrainians after yesterday was spent with the complete bozo attempt of the White House to bring back any sort of coherence to their policy on Ukraine. The President of the United States tried to clean up desperately the terrible press conference, maybe the worst press conference in history yesterday, talking to White House reporters. Reading, actually. They didn't let him freelance anything. He read it yesterday. His attempt to walk it back may or may not be successful, but he tried. That's what he tried to do. And Joe Biden at the White House, cut number one.
Let me start by first saying a few words about Russia and Ukraine. I've been absolutely clear with President Putin. He has no misunderstanding. If any assembled Russian units move across the Ukrainian border, that is an invasion. But it will be met with severe and coordinated economic response that I've discussed in detail with our allies, as well as laid out very clearly for President Putin. But there is no doubt, let there be no doubt at all, that if Putin makes this choice, Russia will pay a heavy price. It's also not the only scenario we need to be prepared for. Russia has a long history of using measures other than overt military action to carry out aggression. And paramilitary tactics, so-called gray zone attacks, and actions by Russian soldiers not wearing Russian uniforms. Remember when they moved into Donbass, the little green men? They were dealing with those who were Russian sympathizers and said that Russia had nobody in there. Well, that includes little green men in uniforms as well as cyber attack. We have to be ready to respond to these as well in a decisive and united way with a range of tools at our disposal. The Ukrainian foreign minister said this morning that he's confident of our support and resolve, and he has a right to be.
Well, no, he doesn't believe that. Zelensky and the foreign minister tweeted throughout the day that great powers should not forget that there are no such things as minor incursions. It may be the worst press conference in presidential history, given the consequences. Mitch McConnell went on Fox News with Brett Baer last night and discussed minor incursion. Cut number 38.
Well, if I were the president, I don't think I'd have a two-hour press conference again. But look, let's just focus on the one thing that was the most disturbing that was already covered in your setup piece, and that was a potential signal to the Russians that it's okay to take some of Ukraine. Now, I'm really glad the White House walked that back today. I hope Vladimir Putin doesn't misunderstand the message. No incursion into Ukraine is acceptable. What should we be doing about it right
now? So that was the
number
one message.
Well, first,
Leader McConnell went on and did what President Trump should have done, what President Biden should have done, doing him a bipartisan favor, showing that national security issues are bilateral issues, are bipartisan issues, and trying to undo the damage done by the president. By the way, Kamala Harris was a train wreck yesterday on the Today Show. But then Leader McConnell was pressed by Brett Baer, okay, what is your agenda? And this is what he said, cut 39. Listen closely to Mitch McConnell.
Look, I don't think the American people are clamoring for any pieces of Build Back Better. They want us to tackle on the problems that they're concerned about. Inflation at the top of the list. A wide open border. We've already discussed the threat against Ukraine. Those are the things the American people are thinking about. The president needs to sync up his plans with things that people are interested in. They've been off on this toot over voting rights, for example. Well, 94% of the American people think it's easy to vote right now. We had a record turnout last year, the highest turnout since 1900, 120 years ago. Nobody's being discriminated against in voting. The Voting Rights Act is still intact, passed in 1965. I actually was there to witness it as a young intern here on Capitol Hill. They're making this up. Why are they doing it? They want a federal takeover of how every election in America is conducted. That is not how this country has been run for over 200 years. It's not what the American people are interested in having them do, but since 94% of them already think it's easy to vote.
So here then Brett came to me to analyze what Leader McConnell had to say, and I said cut number 41.
Hugh? I'm always impressed with the leader, Brett, methodical on message, Mitch McConnell. And he wrote in his memoir 5 years ago, The Long Game, you can start too late, but you can never start too early. And tonight you heard him start early on the fall elections. Inflation and the open southern border. Inflation and the open southern border. And drilling down on, of course, minor incursion. He probably also knows about the new poll this morning, the NBC poll, that when asked, are you a supporter of the Republican Party or a supporter of Donald Trump? 56% said the GOP, 36% said Donald Trump. Now, he avoided twice. You pressed him twice on the former president. He's not looking for a fight with Mar-a-Lago, but neither is he going to yield his leadership position. And he had two big wins last night, big enough wins that Lindsey Graham, who had thrown a couple of darts at him earlier in the week, was praising him on Twitter last night. So good week for the leader. A good message to you. Very methodical.
Very methodical Mitch. They had, you know, they call him Moscow Mitch. They call him the Grim Reaper. They call him, well, many, many different names for Moscow Mitch and Grim Reaper. And the master of the Senate is the one that matters, and Mr. Long Game. But I like methodical on message Mitch. President Trump, meanwhile, went on Fox News with Hannity last night. And Sean asked him about reports. As I had asked Robert O'Brien, his former national security advisor, yesterday morning, about reports that there was a rift between Ron DeSantis and President Trump. And I heard Robert O'Brien say on this show, fake news. And the president said to Sean Hannity last night, cut 37.
Well, he is right. I get along great with Ron. Ron was very good on the Mueller hoax. He was right up front along with Jim Jordan and all of the rest of them. They were fantastic. The Republicans really stuck together. And it was a great thing, and Ron was one of them, and Ron wanted to run, and I endorsed him, and that helped him greatly, and he went on, and he's done a really terrific job in Florida, and I think, you know, Ron has been very good. He's been a friend of mine for a long time. It's totally fake news. I think Ron said last week, he said it very publicly, he says, the press is never going to get in the middle of my friendship with Donald Trump. We're not going to do that stuff. And he said it very strongly. I thought it was very interesting, actually, and very nice. But he said that, and I agree with him on that 100%. No, I have a very good relationship with
There's
Ron.
There's no
And intend
riff.
To have it
None. I'll be writing about
for
this
a long
for the
time.
Washington Post today or Monday. Finally, President Trump, former President Trump, talking with Sean Hannity last night about the disastrous press conference. Let's play cut 36.
So we took in hundreds of billions of dollars from China with taxes and tariffs, and companies started moving back because it was no longer so good to be there, and we had a huge impact. Then you look at what happened with, if you take a look at what happened with everything having to do with Russia, really what he said last night when he said they may go in, they will go in, and he talked about a minor incursion, and I sort of said, I don't believe he said that. Because that's like giving him, you know, they use the term green light. He was green lighted. And, you know, it's very interesting because the president of Ukraine last night, he was seen in some very unusual pictures. He couldn't believe what he heard. He couldn't believe what he heard. And I couldn't believe what, if whether you're for strong stoppage or not, you're really telling him you might as well go in. And you also can't just talk in terms of sanctions, because sanctions don't mean too much to Russia. If you want to stop somebody, you're not going to be talking just about sanctions. But he really told them, go in. I think it's a whole different ballgame right now. If you look at what's going on with Russia and Ukraine, what they've done at the border, they're loaded up with soldiers. That never happened with me. That would have never happened. I had a very good relationship with Putin. But remember, I stopped their pipeline. If we would go back to producing energy, you know, we were energy independent, first time in probably 72 years, maybe ever, but the first time in at least 72 years, we had so much energy we didn't know what to do with it. $1.87 at the pumps when I left, Now it's over $5. In California, it's over $7.
What the president will get to is pointing out that by cutting off energy production in the United States, as Joe Biden has done, he has increased the leverage that Russia has over the world, given them more money for their adventures, made Putin a rich man. Yes, Joe Biden's no good, horrible, very bad week continued yesterday. The vice president did him no favors on the Today Show. We'll cover that when I return to the Hugh Hewitt Show. This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
They had the wheel and letting them change all the laws so they could just send 300 million ballots out and ballot harvest, because if they do that, we can never ever win another election. It's an impossibility.
Which is the goal, which is their goal. That's exactly that's
I know it is.
That's
but what are we doing to counter it?
we're passing election integrity laws in red states, at least.
Yeah.
And they're swing states, and they're important states.
Yeah.
And you know, you said something that makes me realize, being asleep at the switch, they better not be. If they're not aware of voter integrity by now, they never will be. If they're so dumb that they don't know how the Democrats have tried to manipulate COVID into using, you know, to upending our election system.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
49% of Americans that were polled say they more identify, they sympathize more with Democrats than with Republicans. 40% Republicans, 49% Democrats. Let me say that again. 49% Democrats, 40% Republicans. That's 1 year ago. In the second quarter of 2021, Republicans were at 43% and Democrats did not move. They were still at 49%. That's probably because some Republicans might have been a little sour about January 6th or kind of what happened, how we lost the Georgia Senate runoffs, and they were done. But they came back home, and we saw that in a variety of different types of numbers.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
You called your son. You personally promised him you would be here.
Lucas, I don't know how to help you.
Your daddy loves you, you gotta know it, pal. Do you feel
the love? Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work. If you believe.
What reason does he have to care about some guy who's supposed to be his dad, but he's never around?
I can't do it. I can't. I'm not ready for this, man.
I'm done with you.
We all deserve a second chance, right, Ethan?
Look,
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Sad to report that Meatloaf, the Bat Out of Hell singer, passed away at the age of 74 overnight. I think this is one of the anthems of my generation. People liked it a lot. He's a wild guy. Had a wild look and a wild voice. Let me go back, though, to speaking of wild voice. Kamala Harris did no favors for Joe Biden and the Democrats yesterday by sitting down with Savannah Guthrie, getting pushed around because she was haughty, touchy, irascible, and unlikable. Cut number three.
The president said yesterday, among other things, that he thinks that Putin probably will invade Ukraine. Later he said he wasn't sure, but he said he probably will go in. Is that, for all intents and purposes, acknowledging that this threat of severe sanctions that the administration has made is having no effect on Putin, that he's actually not deterred by it?
Well, I'm not going to psychoanalyze President Putin of Russia, but I will tell you this. It is clear to us that the decision is probably in his hands.
Okay, that's very helpful. Cut number five.
Speaking of democracy and politics, the president put a lot of blame yesterday on Republicans for failure to get some of these key initiatives passed. But, you know, you have a 50-50 tie in the United States Senate, as you are well aware. Did the administration fail to temper its initiatives to meet political reality? In other words, should you have been more willing to compromise to try to get all Democrats on board? These initiatives failed because Democrats weren't united, let alone Republicans. Was that an error as you look back on this year?
Well, when I look back on this year, I think about things like the bipartisan infrastructure law. Administrations, both Democrat and Republican, have tried for years.
Well, doesn't that show Republicans were willing to help if the initiatives were good?
But they tried for years to do what the American people want, and what the American people know is not an issue that should be thought of through a political lens. Things like upgrading our roads and bridges, things like cleaning out the lead pipes of America because over 50% of children under the age of six are exposed to lead. These are the things that are part of the accomplishments that occur through a process of compromise, yes. But what ends up happening is that the American people benefit. Broadband in that law is going to be now more accessible and affordable to Americans around the country, from rural areas to urban areas.
Well, Vice President Kamala Harris, I am way out of time. Next time they got to give us an hour so I don't have to interrupt and you can go as long as you want.
Well, in fact, she's just on talking points. I've got to play for you, though, the exchange on elections. Cut number six between Savannah Guthrie and the vice president.
Let's talk about another comment the president made. He openly cast doubt on whether the 2022 midterm elections would be legitimate. He said it all depends, which is astonishing to hear a president question whether our elections will be legitimate. We've heard it before, but not from this president. Is he really concerned that we may not have fair and free elections?
The president has been consistent on this issue, and the issue at hand, the issue, I was there last night in the chamber of the Senate, and the issue is that there are two bills, the John Lewis Voting Rights Act and the Freedom to Vote Act, that have been the solution that has been offered to address the fact that around our country, states have put in place laws that are purposely making it more difficult for the American people to vote. Laws which will be felt by at least 55 million Americans, regardless of their party affiliation, their race, their gender, or their geographic location.
Well, to the point, though, because so those bills were debated. The bills were debated and they didn't pass. But the specific question, if you don't mind, does he think, now that these bills haven't been passed, that the 22 midterms won't be legitimate or fair or free?
Let's not conflate issues. So what we are looking at, and
she's the worst. She is really the worst public presenter. I thought she had talent. She does not have skills. And she is going to be his running mate, according to the befuddled Joe Biden. Stay tuned, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
More happy. There's another proof that goodness and happiness are related. You can neither be good nor happy if you don't fight your nature. What a big deal. So I ask again, how many of you were told that by your parents, and how many of you told that to your children? Hey, you want to be happy, son? You want to be happy, daughter? Fight your nature. It's unspoken. On the contrary, I've been to many, 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 many homes, more homes than anyone but realtors, because I've given so many talks in homes. And I'm always taken aback when I'm in a home, and I'm usually in the home of people who would be deemed conservative, and there will be one of those plaques chiseled into which is a statement such as follow your heart. I can't think of worse advice if you either want to be a good person or a happy person than follow your heart. I got that, of course, from the Bible, which warns more than any other warning, I believe, and that is, don't follow your heart. Another perfect conflict between Judeo-Christian values and secular values, particularly those of the progressive left, as they are called. You want to be happy? Fight your heart.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Here's the current CDC director, Rochelle Walensky, telling us exactly the percentage of people who've died from COVID who had at least four comorbidities.
The overwhelming number of deaths, over 75%, occurred.
Did you say 75%? She did say 75%. I think she said 75%.
The overwhelming number of deaths, over 75%, occurred in people who had at least four comorbidities. So really, these are people who were unwell to begin with.
Dr. Zeke Emanuel, one of the authors of Obamacare, says this now.
We're not getting rid of COVID. It's not going to disappear. We're not going to eradicate it. We're going to have to learn to live with it, just like we learned to live with RSV, adenovirus, flu. We're not there yet. When you have 140,000 hospitalizations, you have 1,500 deaths a day, you're not at a situation where we can live with it normally. We still have to combat it to bring that mortality rate down to about 100 people a day, to bring the hospitalizations down. But once we're down, we have to sustain it, and we will live with it. We'll be in the new normal.
But of the ones who've died, had at least four comorbidities, according to the CDC director, Dana Lesh.
Quick note as well. I mean, if this is about following the science and if this is about mitigating the effects of the virus, and I just got over Omicron, by the way, and it's a glorified cold. And yes, I was prescribed ivermectin by my doctor, and it did help ease my symptoms, and I didn't turn into a horse. So, you know, there you go for that. But the whole issue, if we're following science and we're following facts, we need to be able to have these discussions, because part of science is asking questions.
We come back. Leo Hanian from UCLA, article in CNN.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt in California this morning. Thank you on this Friday, the 21st day of January in the year of our Lord, 2022. Kamala Harris, the White House was so desperate yesterday after the worst press conference in many, many decades, because Joe Biden's endless series of gaffes have always been politically disastrous, but they haven't caused a country to be at risk of invasion and its warriors at risk of death and its civilians at risk of starvation. A minor bit of Ukraine, you know, is that a mile? Is it 20 miles? Is it 30 miles? Is Taiwan a minor gulp from China? Is the Sakaku Islands a minor gulp for China's People's Liberation Army Navy? Questions I'll ask Secretary Pompeo at the start of the next hour. But they were so desperate to try and stop the free fall. I mean, the president can't go much lower. His AP disapproval rating is at 54%. His approval rating in Quinnipiac is at 33%. He could go below 30%. He's lower than Trump was at a similar point in the presidency. And he doesn't have any energy or competence to come back. And his idea that he's running in 2024 is simply laughable. So they were obliged to send out Kamala Harris. And they did. They sent her not only to Savannah Guthrie, where she got sliced and diced, they sent her to talk to the CBS show with Gayle King. Here she is laughing about the virus. Killed 800,000 Americans, laughing away. Cut number eight.
Let's talk about COVID, because you all ran on, we are going to get COVID under control. We are going to get this lit. And as we sit here today, as you know, we're going into year three. We are still talking about COVID. You all admit it. Listen, we've made some mistakes. We're going to do better. We're going to be better. The schools, can the kids go to schools? In New Mexico, the National Guard is being asked to be substitute teachers, all because of COVID. So it is not under control. So I'm wondering, what is your strategy here? And have you come to the point that we have all got to figure out how to live with COVID?
So I'm going to try to unpack the various
there's a lot. Yeah, don't laugh about that lot. She tried. Cut number nine.
Let's turn to Ukraine and Russia, because I'm wondering if you all are having a cleanup in aisle three in the State Department today, where the president raised a couple of eyebrows when he seemed to make the distinction between a minor incursion and an all-out invasion. And so the people in Ukraine today, we understand, are very upset with that because they believe that the president has given Biden, has given rather President Putin the green light. What do you say to that? Because it does seem to be very confusing.
So the president, let me just first tell you, I start every morning reading the presidential daily briefing, which contains classified information about threats to our national security and hotspots around the world. I am often in meetings in the Situation Room where the president and I and members of our leadership of our military, our intelligence community convene on these issues. The president of the United States, Joe Biden, has been very clear on the subject of Ukraine, which is that if Russia takes aggressive action, there will be severe and swift consequences, that there will be a price to pay.
He didn't seem to say that yesterday, though, at the news conference. That's why there's some, that's why I think clarification is needed.
Well, we are very clear, and we've been very clear with Putin, that any aggressive action taken by Russia will meet a cost, a severe cost.
That is what the president should have said. Ron Klain, the White House chief of staff, scurried over to Morning Joe. They're all going to their safe spaces, right? They're all on NBC and CBS. Ron Klain, who I have enormous respect for, but doesn't want to come on the show because I would ask serious questions, scuttled over to MSNBC's Morning Joe to talk to the 10 people watching, said this, cut number 18.
Why were you all not better prepared for Omicron, especially on the testing front?
Well, first of all, we weren't surprised by Delta, and we were prepared for a future variant after that. What we did was we ramped up dramatically on tests.
Now, we do have a contradiction. Kamala Harris telling the LA Times they were surprised by it, so they haven't got their message straight. Jen Psaki was dispatched to the hostels. Dana Perina is a former press secretary. She's not going to crucify Jen Psaki, but Jen Psaki just lied through her teeth. Cut number 10.
So I'm curious if he will continue to say that those 2022 elections will be illegitimate.
Well, first, I've talked to the president a lot about this, and he absolutely is not predicting that the 2022 elections would be illegitimate. The point he was raising was both that in 2020, even amongst challenging circumstances, efforts to suppress the vote, and the midst of a pandemic, there was record turnout, Democrats and Republicans, record turnout to go to the polls. And the point he was making is that the former president asked a number of states, seven or more, in fact, to overturn the outcome of the election. Now, obviously, if there's an effort to do that, we've got to fight against that. That's what our commitment is to doing. But he was not making a prediction. He has confidence in the American people, and we're going to do everything we can to protect people's rights.
He mentioned the minority vote. I mean, he was pretty brash about it.
Yeah, he was pretty brash about it. The same question comes to Jen Psaki from Jake Tapper at CNN. Yes, even from CNN is not buying this stuff. Cut 11.
So I get that there are efforts on the state level, because this is also what the president was trying to tie it to, efforts on the state level to make it more difficult to vote. Some of that is no doubt born from the big lie. Some of it is nefarious. Some of it is election officials saying we're not in the middle of the pandemic like we were in November 2020. We don't need to do everything like we did. But I guess my bigger question is, if we're saying that there's no election that's legitimate if there are efforts to suppress the vote, then when has there ever been a legitimate election in this country? Trying to suppress American votes has been going on since the founding of this country.
That's not what we're saying, Jake. People should be confident in the protections that we are going to continue to enforce. But also, we know it's not long ago history. It is recent history.
Sure.
When the former president tried to overturn the outcome. That is different than the effort to suppress the vote. We need to fight against both. We need to ensure we're using every tool at our disposal. Obviously, a lot of those would be through the Democratic National Committee, and a lot of those are going to be through local efforts. And that's what the president was attempting to speak to.
But he didn't say the elections are going to be legitimate and I'm going to be there making sure that they are legitimate and we're going to fight and you need to turn out to vote. I mean, he basically refused to say that definitively that they're going to be legitimate. Vice President Harris today, also with Savannah Guthrie, also refused to say that the results will be legitimate. She pivoted to saying, quote, we as America cannot afford to allow this blatant erosion of our democracy and in particular the right of all Americans who are eligible to vote to have access to the ballot unfettered. So I hear what you're saying, but you do not seem to be on the same page as the president and vice president.
I've spoken with the president about this extensively. I speak on his behalf. He is not questioning the legitimacy of the 2022 elections, but it is also his responsibility and the vice president's too, to be very candid and clear-eyed and communicate with the American people about what is at risk and what they need to ensure they know what their rights are and what the former president attempted to do in 2020. And we can't forget and stop talking about that.
Moving on to Russia and Ukraine, I want to get your reaction to what
that Joe Biden left from his, you know, yesterday his fan boys and fangirls in the legacy media inside the Beltway were praising him 2 days ago, the press conference, disaster day, praising him for going 2 hours. It took about 30 minutes for them to realize it was a disaster. Not long enough that they hadn't already gone on and tried to spin. They can't spin that. The entire country watched that. I looked at the ratings last night. 3.5 million people were watching Special Report after the, you know, I stopped watching the press conference, went on Special Report, and I looked at the ratings, and 3.5 million people, more people watched on Fox. They wanted to see the whole thing, and they watched the Fox News feed. And then they saw the panel and Brett and I talking about it, and it was an utter fiasco. Everybody knows that was, if not the worst presidential press conference in history, certainly the worst one of the last many years. And President Trump had some bad ones. He had some very good ones. But this was 2 hours of bad, out of touch, read my notes, flummoxed, flustered, unsure of what he's saying, reversing course, midfield course correction, yes is no, up is down, left is right, sky is green stuff. And Joe Biden is not good at this. He's infirm. And it took a lot out of him, and he got worse as it went on, and he got angry and garrulous and mad. But the most important thing to remember, and what I'll talk about with Secretary of State Pompeo next hour, is what he said, cut number 42 first.
I'm not so sure that he has is certain what he's going to do. My guess is he will move in. He has to do something.
And then cut number 43.
So I think what you're going to see is that Russia will be held accountable if it invades. And it depends on what it does. It's one thing if it's a minor incursion and then we end up having a fight about what to do and not do, et cetera.
Well, you know, it will live in infamy, in diplomatic and national security infamy. That press conference, minor incursion. Let me check markets. The markets were mixed yesterday, and that's because they can't figure out what the heck he's talking about. Actually, they weren't mixed. They were all down. The Dow was down 0.89%. The S&P down 1%. The NASDAQ down 1.3%. Overseas this morning, everything is red. England down almost 1%. Germany down 1.5%. France down 1.3%, because they're worried about war in Europe, because the president said, minor incursion, who knows, maybe that's Poland, maybe it's Lithuania, who knows where that goes. That's what the president wasn't saying, Poland, Lithuania, but minor incursion lacks any definition in history. It's sort of like a small country far away with a people we know little about, Neville Chamberlain's characterization of Czechoslovakia when he gave that to Hitler. Gold, however, went up, not surprisingly, to $1,834 an ounce. If you're going to buy gold because you're uncertain of the world, buy it from Birch Gold. Go to hughgold.com. Very straightforward. They will sell you gold. I recommend Maple Leafs and Canadian Maple Leafs, American Eagles, or Krugerrands. 1 ounce costs $1,834. Or roll over a portion of your IRA or SEP IRA or 401k into a Birch Gold maintained deposit of the same value in gold and silver that you could buy, but it increases or sits there. You can't access it except through the agent that is Birch Gold, as you can't access a 401 except through your 401 custodian. And the IRS respects that. They will treat it legally. The profits from it will not be taxed until you withdraw it from your Birch Gold account. To get information on that easy setup, go to hughgold.com or text my name, Hugh, to 989898. That's hughgold.com or text my name, Hugh, to 989898. Thousands of five-star reviews for Birch Gold. You can trust them. You can trust them completely. It is time this morning, as it is every morning at this hour, to take my relieffactor.com. And there it is. I am not going to take it this morning because I am on the, I've got to go for my annual physical today. And I'm supposed to fast. I'm allowed to have coffee. I'm not sure I can take my anti-inflammatory, nature's anti-inflammatories, but I'll leave it right here in the studio. And when I come back up later today after my annual physical, I will take my relieffactor.com. I hope all of you are doing an annual physical. My doctor has kept going on throughout the, one of the reasons we come back to California is I don't want to shuffle doctors. All of my doctors are out here and they just marvel at the shape I'm in. And I always credit Relief Factor, 1995, because it keeps me going, keeps me running, keeps me moving, keeps me walking every day of the week. You ought to take it every day of the week. 1995, relieffactor.com. Tarzana Joe is next.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group. Streaming on Salem Now.
¿Cuánto queda?
No queda nada. Que lo siento mucho.
Have you ever thought of going to seminary?
Madre, padre, ¿quién está listo para ser transformado por el poder de su palabra?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I'll have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah. I'm going to get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd. A bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
It's the devil! Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
When you had the president in Atlanta saying to the crowd there that, you know, he didn't march in the shoes of the students that are marching today, but that he marched in the civil rights movement, the leader of North Korea, the leader of Iran, these people all see it too. And there is a message being sent globally that America is a laughingstock right now. That the bowl of mashed potatoes that serves as the president in the White House right now is nothing more than a suit.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com.
Joined now by the poet laureate of the Hugh Hewitt Show. After a long week, Joe, and a very long press conference, I hope you make us laugh.
I'll do my best. Although, I must say, every week I'm always
anxious and excited to say what I have to say on the radio. What a wonderful opportunity. But this week, it's very hard to say what I want to say. Approaching the quadrennial, my spirit swells with pride, thinking of the athletes and those guys with rocks who slide. I love to spend my winter evenings tuning in and rooting, seeing skiers jumping and some other skiers shooting. And though I was a goalie, as a skater I'm a klutz. Still, I like to watch when someone lands a double lutz. The thrill of every victory as rivalries take shape. The agony of knowing that I'm watching it on tape. Then when the games are over, how I wish they'd lasted longer, inspired as I am by thinking faster, higher, stronger. But this year something's different. The games have lost their fizz. And I've spent some time now thinking just what that something is. The contestants are as plucky as any I've perused. So what is it that's not the same? I'm very much confused. Now, when I was a kid, there was this bully, don't you know, who liked to knock us down and rub our faces in the snow. That wasn't very pleasant. And this is quite revealing. The way I felt back then is very like the way I'm feeling. Although I'd like to see just how the networks spew this spin, forgive me when I say that I will not be tuning in. And that's very hard to say. By Tarzana Joe.
Well, it didn't make me laugh, but it did make me think, and I'm glad you wrote that, Joe, because I won't be tuning in either. Joe, I you do, however, remind me, you made an assertion there. I do fact-checking in real time, like the press did to President Trump, but not President Biden. I do fact-checking. You said you played hockey. Now, I had rotator cuff surgery when I put together the traveling Hugh Hewitt team in Minnesota, and you were definitely out on the ice. As was Chad the Elder.
Hockey? Is that what you're saying? You're looking for?
I'm just saying that I saw that game. I was there, and I couldn't rescue the team. Dwayne was out there trying to stand aloft. Chad the Elder was getting beat left, right, center. And I think you got scored on a few times, didn't you?
Yeah, a few times. But here's the thing. Okay, and I don't know if I've ever discussed this with you, but I wear contact lenses when I play goalie. And they locked my contact lenses in the locker room.
Oh, so that's like the field is wet. That's like the field is wet. That's John Campbell-esque.
The field was wet.
Yeah, that is a new, put that on the machine. They locked my contact lenses.
True. I had to play
Joe,
with my glasses.
You don't need a poem about that. You need to go to work right now and explain how one gets out of that.
And one more thing. Yeah, didn't have any pegs in the goalie, in the goalpost. So the goal kept sliding back and forth. Come on. I mean, I have a vivid memory of that day.
Oh, Joe. Tarzana Joe. Such a performance. You're like Joe Biden in a press conference, Joe.
Well, I wanted to make you laugh, and I've succeeded.
Oh, there you did. Oh, is TarzanaJoe.com going to post everything?
Absolutely.
And if you need a poem, especially one that excuses your contact lenses, write to Joe at TarzanaJoe@Reagan.com and do so today. TarzanaJoe@Reagan.com for all your poetry needs. Thank you, Joe. Yeah, you know, that is such a legendary hockey game. I'm appealing to the good people of Minnesota on AM 1280 The Patriot. If you have any video or pictures of that game, can you please send them to me? I've never heard the contact lens excuse before. Dwayne was, air quotes if you're not watching on the Salem News Channel, Dwayne was on the ice. We did a number of promotions. Hugh Hewitt on ice. Hugh Hewitt on ice twice. Hugh Hewitt on ice thrice. Hugh Hewitt on ice Roman numeral 4. We did a hockey game. We did snowmobiles. We did ice fishing. We did skiing. And Dwayne was always involved, and so we had to put Dwayne up on skates, which was like having a bear on skates. All right, so, a bear on a ball at a circus, that's like having Dwayne on skates. And he stood there in the middle, right in whatever they call the middle of that arena. And he slowly...
You mean like center ice?
The
middle?
Center ice.
Center ice?
Middle.
Right.
And you just kind of turn like the ballerina in the music box.
I was a pinwheel.
No, it was the ballerina in the music box. You slowly rotated. I've got a rotating chair if people are watching on Salem News Channel.
I didn't.
And by the time Dwayne
once.
By the time Dwayne got back, the game had gone by him two or three times. And we had in the goal on the other end, a member of the Minnesota Wild was playing. So Chad the Elder, who fancied himself a skater, he tried to score on the Minnesota Wild goalie. It was funny. It was, the old Looney Tunes cartoons where Foghorn Leghorn puts his arm out with the little chicken and says, I'll say, boy, that was Chad the Elder trying to score. I've never seen a more pathetic hockey game, except Chad didn't tell me he left his contact lenses in the locker room. Joe, Tarzana Joe, is now the hockey goalie equivalent of Joe Biden. The story has changed. How Joe Biden's been arrested many times, except he hasn't. You know, he went 41,000 miles or 17,000 miles with President Xi, the dictator, except he hasn't. Joe, the TarzanaJoe.com, playing hockey, except he didn't. I'm coming back with former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, Florida Senator Rick Scott. There's a lot more on the Friday edition of the Hugh Hewitt Show rolling up to the Hillsdale Dialogue in the last radio hour of the week. Don't go anywhere, America. It is the Hugh Hewitt Show.
The Hugh Hewitt Show is now available on TV. Go to salemnewschannel.com or download the app. You can also watch on Roku and Fire Stick. Salem News Channel, the antidote to the mainstream media.
Broadly supported by senators representing a broader cross-section of Americans, a guardrail, inevitably viewed as an obstacle by whoever holds the Senate majority, but which in reality ensures that millions of Americans represented by the minority party have a voice in the process.
Do you know how much guts it has to take for Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin to withstand the pressure they're getting right now? I mean, Pelosi has a scheme. The Biden administration has a scheme. The scheme is break the Senate, get rid of the filibuster, something that they literally used yesterday. This is what clowns they are. Did you know that just this week, the Democrats in the Senate used the filibuster against Ted Cruz? So while they're desperately trying to eliminate the filibuster, I mean, that's unbelievable. This is what I mean about unserious people. This is not a serious agenda. It's a diabolical agenda. Break the Senate rules so that we can jam through voting rights, wink, wink, and upend the election process forever so that we can cheat and steal elections forever.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
You called your son. You personally promised him you would be here.
Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet with 3 years to go is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
49% of Americans that were polled say they more identify, they sympathize more with Democrats than with Republicans. 40% Republicans, 49% Democrats. Let me say that again. 49% Democrats, 40% Republicans. That's 1 year ago. In the second quarter of 2021, Republicans were at 43% and Democrats did not move. They were still at 49%. That's probably because some Republicans might have been a little sour about January 6th or kind of what happened, how we lost the Georgia Senate runoffs and they were done. But they came back home and we saw that in a variety of different types of numbers.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
States' rights, which of course the very term is maligned by the left, they hate states' rights for the same reason they hate independent countries in Europe. The left hates Brexit, the British exit from the EU. The thought that you will not be controlled by Brussels infuriates the left. The left is about control. For those of us who are not animated by controlling other people, this is sort of, not sort of, it is actually not comprehensible. I do not understand, I understand a lot of sins. Here's a sin I don't understand, the desire to control other people's lives.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
The most powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
But he knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified. I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified. You can't see it.
Collusion. You just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not going to accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're fighting Russian spies and Nazis.
Russiagate has been the most egregious abuse of everything that was supposed to have been good about our government.
The thing that they were investigating the Trump campaign for is what they themselves were doing.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Of that, transform their private school or home school into a government classroom. Under our bill, that's very clear that you can't. Unfortunately, Grinnell's drafting committee did not take proper notice of these things, and the bill is much weaker than it should be. I'll give them credit for school choice, but the internals are bad. This is why our bill is really the Cadillac of the business and the way to go.
I'm talking to Michael Alexander, president and founder of Californian for School Choice, the website he gave, californiaschoolchoice.org, California.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live in California this morning, joined by former Secretary of State of the United States, the Honorable Mike Pompeo. Good morning, Mr. Secretary. Welcome back to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Good morning, Hugh. It is great to be back with you.
Thank you for joining me. Just to set the stage for those who have not heard anything and been in a cave for a day, on Wednesday, President Biden, at an infamous now press conference, said two things I'd like you to comment on. First, cut number 42.
I'm not so sure that he has David, I'm not so sure he has is certain what he's going to do. My guess is he will move in. He has to do something.
And then cut number 43.
So I think what you're going to see is that Russia will be held accountable if it invades. And it depends on what it does. It's one thing if it's a minor incursion, and then we end up having a fight about what to do and not do, etc.
They have been trying desperately to clarify this, Secretary Pompeo, since he uttered those two sentences. What did you make of the press conference? What do you make of its aftermath?
Well, Hugh, more importantly than what I think President Zelensky spoke to this very directly. There are no minor nations. There are no minor incursions. To have said that out loud, whether there were discussions in the background, probably with the Germans, about how we were going to respond given the nature of what Vladimir Putin might do. I understand those conversations, but to have done this, it's more than green light. It tells the world that the United States is not prepared to do the things that it has already promised to do, let alone making additional promises, right? We have this commitment. We've told the Ukrainians we'll do the things we can to do to defend them and to say, well, there are minor incursions and we may not be able to get this done. Is truly concerning. Vladimir Putin, I think, knew this already. In some sense, he wasn't enlightening Putin. I think he knew that President Biden has demonstrated his unwillingness to defend the things that the Trump administration did, and we've lost the deterrence model that we had for 4 years. But it was really quite something to hear a president of the United States say that the former KGB agent, leader of Russia, an authoritarian dictator who has already moved into Kazakhstan, Belarus, into the Donbass, has room to grow and room to expand on his old Warsaw Pact network was really quite something. And I think the world took note. You can be sure that the Ukrainian people did.
Now, Mr. Secretary, this is your world from the CIA and the State Department and not the world of me or my listeners. Does Vladimir Putin now feel obliged to move or look weak to his people? And does yesterday's attempt to repair the political damage oblige Joe Biden to respond disproportionately to anything? And in other words, did the whole thing get blown up yesterday, 2 days ago?
It's a fair question. I don't think this changes Vladimir Putin's calculus materially. I think it reaffirms what he already knew. But his risk-benefit analysis probably didn't change yesterday. I think he had a good handle on the fact that his movement will have a relatively safe space and is unlikely to meet steel until he's accomplished at least some, if not all, of the things he wants, whether that's through rolling tanks and a motorized rifle division into Ukraine. If you think about the geography, it's likely that what he would try to do is capture Odessa, right? He would move to the west to try to cut off Ukraine, to cut it off from having access to ports and waterways. It's thinkable that you could see the troops that he's moved into Belarus. It's not far to Kaliningrad. For those listening, that's an old Soviet vestige of a deal that was cut before that sits astride Europe. It's not far from Western Belarus to make this trip along the Lithuanian border to get there. I think that's probably a bridge too far. But to hear President Biden say this is green-lit and he now must do this, I think misses the point. Putin's going to do what makes sense for Vladimir Putin and his oligarchs, and he now believes he can do it against the United States. It's not prepared to do the simple things of supporting our European allies in the region and providing the defensive weapon systems that the Ukrainians need. Will ultimately need to carry this fight.
Mr. Secretary, I was on after the press conference with Brett Baer on Special Report, and I tried to indicate it's a major deal. I brought up Dean Acheson's January 1950 press club speech, which apparently green-lighted in the eyes of many North Korea's invasion of South Korea. Ambassador O'Brien on the show yesterday compared it to the July 25th meeting between Saddam Hussein and Ambassador April Glispie. What do you think it is?
Yeah, you can't clean this up, Hugh. I saw this in my 4 years as Secretary of State. The presidents speak, their words are understood. When his team goes out afterwards and says, no, that's not what he means, they go back and watch the tape. We know precisely what President Biden was thinking and talking about there, and so does the entire world. It certainly has ramifications for the Ukrainian people, for the region, for our friends in Eastern Europe, Poland, and in the Baltics. But I think the whole world saw a president go on and said, look, there are things you can get away with now that you couldn't get away with a few years ago, and this portends real risk for the United States and our interests around the world as a result of this. You can't clean it up, Hugh. No chief of staff, no White House spokesperson, no off-the-record deputy national security advisor can fix what the president of the United States told the world that day.
Now, in minor incursion, in Putin's mind, do you think that would include Lithuania or the disputed portion? They're not in dispute, but Putin attempts to dispute the portions of the Baltic borders. Do you think minor incursion encourages him to look there?
I don't think Vladimir Putin thinks in terms of minor or major incursion. I think he sees it that way. He sees the dissolution of the Soviet Union as the greatest calamity of last century, and he's aiming to fix it. If he has to do so piecemeal and chunk by chunk, this will be his plan. And so it was Crimea 6 years ago, and I think his efforts in the Donbas over the last years are continuing to lay the base. You see the troop movements. You see equipment moving in. The equipment moving in as well to Belarus and into Western Russia. This portends Vladimir Putin, who has made a decision that he's going to push just as far as he can until he meets resistance. He doesn't say, I'm going to do a major incursion or a minor incursion. He says, I'm going to go achieve the imperialistic agenda that I have for my country.
Now, we have to think about the Chinese Communist Party as well, Mr. Secretary, about Taiwan, about the Senkaku Islands, about islands off the Philippines that are part of the Philippines. Did that statement register in Beijing?
This was my point about others around the world hearing this as well. Certainly the Chinese Communist Party would observe that. Wouldn't surprise me at all if Chairman Kim observed that too and might decide to do what they alluded to yesterday, go back to begin to test nuclear weapons. Again, a very dangerous thing to the United States of America. Certainly every authoritarian regime, whether it's the Ayatollah, who is still sitting with our team in Vienna, in spite of the fact he's now fired rockets at places that many Americans are in Abu Dhabi, ballistic missiles into our friend and ally, the United Arab Emirates. No, these authoritarian thugs understand one thing. They understand power. Deterrence can only be achieved through strength. And when you see a president say, this is a minor incursion, and gosh, we know he has to do something now to save face, suggesting somehow that the United States would permit this in order to allow Vladimir Putin to save face, right? The implication was, Hugh, that this was inevitable. Right, that Vladimir Putin had to do this, and gosh darn it, who are we to stop him from this inevitability? This is not the kind of talk United States presidents engage in when deterrence is the objective.
There's a famous quote, a small country far away and a people about whom we know little. That's Neville Chamberlain describing the giveaway of Czechoslovakia to Hitler in the Munich negotiation. Is there an air of appeasement about this administration?
We've seen it on multiple fronts. Whether it was the way in which Afghanistan was abandoned to leave 13 Americans dead and many Americans still behind. We've certainly seen that with respect to what happened when the Russians shut down our pipelines in Southeast United States, when Russian hackers from their own country did that. We appeased. We said, don't do that again. We gave the Russians a treaty without asking for anything to start. We allowed them to build out without being sanctioned the Nord Stream 2 pipeline, gaining power over Germany, which in the end is the mission statement for Vladimir Putin. He will try to strike the fear of God in Germany so that Germany will muck up a NATO response to his efforts in Ukraine. Yes, I think it's absolutely the case that you can feel an administration not prepared to do the things one needs to do to deter, and that is the inverse of appeasement.
At the conclusion of the presser, a frazzled and dismayed president who was quite clearly desperate to turn around the conversation, said this. Cut number 45, please.
I wonder what would be the Republican platform right now.
What do you think? What do you think their position on taxes are? What do you think their position on human rights?
I dropped my pen right there, Mr. Secretary. And I know at CavPack.com, you talk about human rights. What was your position on human rights? Certainly it wasn't giving away Ukraine or going to the Chinese Olympic genocide games.
We defended the Orthodox Church in Ukraine. We defended the Patriarchate in Turkey. We declared the Chinese Communist Party's efforts to co-opt the Catholic Church and conduct genocide in this country. We were proud that we worked on defending the rights of every individual around the world. It doesn't mean putting thousands of soldiers in lots of places, Hugh. It means establishing a benchmark for what America will do to protect not only those people, but the United States itself.
Secretary Mike Pompeo, thank you for joining me. To follow what Secretary Pompeo is doing, go to CavPack.com. You get updates there every day. People ask me where he is. He's at CavPack, working for American security every day. CavPack.com. I'll be right back, America. Stay tuned.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Was Sonia Sotomayor saying to them that there were 100,000 children in hospitals, many of them on ventilators? Eric, I went and looked up the data immediately. If you follow me on Instagram, you know that I've posted regularly the death rates of COVID positive people and heart disease and cancer. There are only 119,000 people hospitalized for COVID in the nation as we sat there that day. So you're saying 100,000 of them were children when the data shows that only 5 children are hospitalized out of every 100,000 hospitalizations. There were maybe 6 kids in the hospital, none of them on ventilators that I could find.
100,000. Who's counting? Hey, we're all about grace, bro.
And it's a whole consistent pattern, Eric, that they used to do kind of in the shade. They would make more implications than direct statements. They wouldn't campaign on things that were factually false. The left has lost its rooting, its mooring,
how many people do we know in the evangelical church who do not give a damn about this? They absolutely don't seem to understand that when leaders lie, when they do these kinds of things, it hurts people. It usually hurts poor people the most, and we have many in the evangelical church who have absolutely turned a blind eye. Again, this rises to levels unprecedented in American life. I mean, it's one thing to say we have differences. This is a level of political theater, of lying and grandstanding that is so pernicious to the fabric of the republic.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com.
Tesla was a genius. His most amazing discoveries thought to be written in a lost journal. Now in the right hands, it could revolutionize the 21st century. But in the wrong hands...
Kill him. Kill him.
If you can stop an earthquake, doesn't that mean you could start one too?
That's why that notebook should never fall into the wrong hands.
There's an old brown battered notebook in my office at work. You have to find it, take it, and keep it hidden at all costs. The G20 leaders meeting downtown, they're in danger. In fact, the whole of downtown could be in danger.
If we are to build a superhuman, we must first eliminate those who are flawed.
People are created equally. All of downtown, the high rises were built on rollers to withstand horizontal shakes. A vertical quake this size could collapse half of downtown.
We have commenced the countdown.
Shall we stop this thing?
Save the universe!
Back.
Charlie Kirk Show.
49% of Americans that were polled say they more identify, they sympathize more with Democrats than with Republicans. 40% Republicans, 49% Democrats. Let me say that again. 49% Democrats, 40% Republicans. That's 1 year ago. In the second quarter of 2021, Republicans were at 43% and Democrats did not move. They were still at 49%. That's probably because some Republicans might have been a little sour about January 6th or kind of what happened, how we lost.
Welcome back. I'm Hugh Hewitt, live in California, 1-800-520-1234. What do you make of the events of the last 48 hours? 1-800-520-1234. The disastrous presser by the president, President Biden's worst 2 hours in the public eye ever. If he'd had even one press conference during the campaign, he wouldn't have won. If they'd had even one serious debate in the primary, he wouldn't have won. If the Presidential Debate Commission, which needs to go away and is in the process of being dismantled by the Republican National Committee and Chairwoman Ronna McDaniel, had set up even one fair confrontation, President Biden would not have won, because he always does this. But now he does it as President of the United States, and the consequences for our allies are terrible. 1-800-520-1234. Last night, Donald Trump went on Hannity to talk with Sean about that disastrous press conference. Here's what he said, cut number 36.
So we took in hundreds of billions of dollars from China with taxes and tariffs, and companies started moving back because it was no longer so good to be there, and we had a huge impact. Then you look at what happened with, if you take a look at what happened with everything having to do with Russia, really what he said last night when he said they may go in, they will go in, and he talked about a minor incursion. And I sort of said, I don't believe he said that, because that's like giving him, you know, they use the term green light. He was green lighted. And, you know, it's very interesting because the president of Ukraine last night, he was seen in some very unusual pictures. He couldn't believe what he heard. He couldn't believe what he heard. And I couldn't believe what, if whether you're for strong stoppage or not, you're really telling him you might as well go in. And you also can't just talk in terms of sanctions, because sanctions don't mean too much to Russia. If you want to stop somebody, you're not going to be talking just about sanctions. But he really told him go in. I think it's a whole different ballgame right now. If you look at what's going on with Russia and Ukraine, what they've done at the border, they're loaded up with soldiers. That never happened with me. That would have never happened. I had a very good relationship with Putin. But remember, I stopped their pipeline. If we would go back to producing energy, you know, we were energy independent, first time in probably 72 years, maybe ever. But the first time in at least 72 years, we had so much energy, we didn't know what to do with it. $1.87 at the pumps when I left. Now it's over $5. In California, it's over $7. The gasoline, if we would get, because inflation is killing us. We haven't talked about inflation. It's killing us. A lot of inflation has to do with the cost of energy, because it's sort of this big topic. It has to do with just about the making of everything. And if we were energy independent, if we got the prices down, your inflation would absolutely start to drop. But I don't think they're going to do it.
Yeah, it's not going to happen. President Trump on with Hannity last night. Trent, Hermosa Beach, California. You're up early. What do you think, Trent?
Yeah, I think that Biden is a horrible president. He, you know, with him and the press, they really hijacked the election, because they kept Biden in the basement. They protected him. They didn't let his obvious flaws get exposed. And the cognitive mapping that's been shaped on the American people over the last 20 years really showed, because people bought it. And they believed that what the press was telling about him, and it's so untrue. and he just really, really frightens me.
Oh, he does, and he showed it off to everyone. Thank you. Thomas in Florida. Good morning, Thomas. What do you say?
Hey, how you doing, Hugh?
Good.
There's no way else to say it. This president's going to drag us into World War III. I mean, this president, the power absorbs the vacuum, and Biden is the vacuum. I mean, it just, he's, you know, projecting peace through strength. You know, the world understands that, right? The dictators of the world understand strength. And it was a reason why, you know, when Trump was president, that these dictators were in a box. You didn't hear about China having designs on Taiwan. I mean, of course they wanted to, but they didn't act on it. Russia wasn't moving.
Yeah, Russia moved under Obama, and it's moving under Biden. The time they didn't move, that was called the Trump presidency. Thomas, thank you. I'm coming right back with Senator Rick Scott, chairman of the National Republican Senatorial Committee. Your senator from Florida, Thomas. Don't go anywhere, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
There's a lot of nurses. There's a lot of x-ray technicians. There's a lot of physician's assistants. There's a lot of doctors who are pretty distraught over the Supreme Court upholding the healthcare industry's mandate. Now, the healthcare industry, hospitals, research facilities, they didn't push back on the mandate the way the private sector did outside of the healthcare arena. And I understand the basis for the Supreme Court ruling, you know, Medicaid dollars involved. I get it. Federal government, in a sense, because of the federal dollars that flow into the healthcare industry, essentially, the Supreme Court ruled that it essentially gives them, the government, the right to have that kind of overreach. But the whole weaponization of OSHA is a joke. Occupational hazard. Occupational hazard. COVID isn't an occupational hazard. COVID is everywhere. To quote the FDA commissioner, we're all going to get it. Doesn't matter if you're working or you're not working. 3/4 of the people I know who have COVID right now or had COVID over the holidays aren't even in the workforce. So either you believe in the principles of keeping the government out of your life or you don't.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
In this issue, Larry, is nonpartisan. It spans every community, regardless of color, party, affiliation. Everybody's for it. I've heard about all the opposition from Democrats, but believe me, the small D Democrats are the ones that are voting for it. And every week on my leadership meeting with my county leaders all over the state, I ask them, who refused to sign it? It's rare, and this no BS in campaign talk. Nobody is refusing to sign it. Everybody's up there, regardless of who they are. Now you got some union people and some political operatives. It's rare. So I think going back to why it hasn't passed in the past, schools were different. The last time this was attempted was 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. Talk with Tim Draper, who backed it at that time. It was really too little money. He was offering $4,000 back then in the bill, nothing to get excited about. Even then, well, this time our bill starts out at $14,000 per year per child, and you can take that money, it'll be held in trust, and you can send the kid to a school of your choice, an accredited private, parochial, or religious school, save anything left over for college. It's beautiful, and it applies to everybody in the state. Now, that is a bill worth getting excited about. That's a bill worth supporting. It's unique because this is the only pure school choice bill in the country that provides immediate access to every student of every color, clime, income, just like the regular public school system.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
This is a story of how a million children were placed with local foster families through an unlikely alliance between the Chinese government and a British footballer. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans. With unprecedented access across the country, this is a unique insight into the lives of the 90s orphans now driving the 21st century's fastest growing economy.
This story needs to be told across the world. At a time where there's so much negativity and cynicism, here's proof that a single leap of faith can change the world.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Go to salemnow.com.
How a million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life.
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt live in California this morning, talking with United States Senator Rick Scott, represents the great state of Florida. He's also chairman of the National Republican Senatorial Committee, regular guest on the show. Senator Scott, welcome back. Good morning to you.
Well, good morning, Hugh. Every month, Biden goes down, and our chances of taking the Senate go back up.
I agree with that. I want to get into that. I want to start, though, with something about which you'll have unique knowledge. The press has been floating the idea that the governor you work with, Ron DeSantis, is your friend, and the former president that you know and visit at Mar-a-Lago, Donald Trump, are having a war. And so President Trump went on Hannity last night and said this, cut number 37.
Well, he is right. I get along great with Ron. Ron was very good on the Mueller hoax. He was right up front along with Jim Jordan and all of the rest of them. They were fantastic. The Republicans really stuck together. And it was a great thing, and Ron was one of them, and Ron wanted to run, and I endorsed him, and that helped him greatly, and he went on, and he's done a really terrific job in Florida, and I think, you know, Ron has been very good. He's been a friend of mine for a long time. It's totally fake news. I think Ron said last week, he said it very publicly, he says, the press is never going to get in the middle of my friendship with Donald Trump. We're not going to do that
stuff. Senator Scott,
and he said
is... Those, there were more than one reports of that feud. Are they fake news?
I talked to both of them, and it's never come up in any of those conversations. And so, I've never seen it. I hope it's not true, and I don't believe it's true. So, but you have to listen, talk to both of them. But it's never come up in my conversation. Every time I'm talking to the president, he's helping me. You know, he's saying, "What can I do to make sure you get the Senate back?"
And I just believe that the media, no, this is my conviction. The media knows that Joe Biden is toast, that your committee and the House counterpart are going to win in the fall. And so they're trying to drum up Donald Trump's stories, even if they have to make up conversations in order to support them. Do you think I'm on the mark?
You know, I think you are, Hugh. It never comes up in my conversations.
All right. Let's go to the consequences of that disastrous presser on Wednesday. First of all, were you watching it live, or did you have to read about it later, Senator Rick Scott?
Well, we were in the middle of working on voting, where they were, you know, remember they were working on getting rid of the filibusters so they could pass the radical agenda. Schumer was in the Senate, so that's where my focus was. But I read about it and I watched it afterwards. And Joe Biden is a clown. He's completely incompetent. He has no plan to deal with anything. He'll pass the buck constantly. Like, he's not responsible for inflation, even though he's the one who shut down the Keystone Pipeline. He's the one who's done nothing. His team has done nothing to deal with the supply chain. His group is the one that get paid people, you know, more money to not work than to work. But he's not has any responsibility for that. He's never responsible for the Afghanistan debacle. He's not responsible for anything. And he has no plan. They don't do anything.
Now, in that press conference, he decided to attack Republicans. I want to play for you Cut 45.
I wonder what would be the Republican platform right now. What do you think? What do you think their position on taxes are? What do you think their position on human rights is?
So, Senator Rick Scott, you're out with all of our candidates. I couldn't believe he teed that up for you that way.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting. Their plan, Biden, Schumer, Pelosi's plan, has been devastating for this country. You look at an open, completely open border. 100,000 people died of drug overdose. China's threatening Taiwan. Russia's on the border of Ukraine. Gas prices up, food prices, shelves empty. I mean, you see all these things, and he wants to just attack Republicans. He's the president. He's responsible. When I was governor of Florida, whatever happened, you had to take responsibility, and you had to solve it. But he has never in his life taken any responsibility, and the Democrats, they're in la-la land. I mean, they're the anti-democracy party. All they want to do is play politics and steal elections.
They have also become, incredibly to me, Senator Scott, the anti-parent party. In Virginia, school boards are rejecting the new governor, Glenn Youngkin's, executive order offering parental choice. Some school districts are considering increasing the quarantine of children. The devastation of children through this COVID has not registered on the Democratic Party at the local, the state, or the national level. Are you advising the candidates you're helping get ready for the fall to concentrate on parental rights and children rights?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think one of the reasons why we're going to win is that parents are going to be involved in these school board races. You know, it's always hard to raise money, get people active in school board races. Not now. All across this country, people are saying that those people have an impact on my kids' future. And I'm not going to let these incompetent people that are controlled by the teachers union run my kids' life and ruin my kids' ability to get a good education, because every parent knows that the future is their kids' education. And so I think we're going to have unbelievable turnover in school boards, and it's going to help Republicans win all across the board, in the House and in the Senate, all across the board this time, and people are going to be active in these school board races.
Now, Senator Rick Scott, I believe, but I won't know until November, that the Democrats' attempt to kill the filibuster was understood by the public to be a radical and destabilizing move to undo the nature of the Senate that has grown up over 120 years. I believe that Mark Kelly in Arizona voting to kill the filibuster, Michael Bennett in Colorado voting to kill the filibuster, Cortez Masto in Las Vegas, Warnock in Georgia, Hassan in New Hampshire, all voting to kill the filibuster, make those five senators vulnerable. Do you agree with me?
Absolutely. I think what everybody is seeing is the Democrats have become the anti-democracy party. They have become very radical. They're controlled by the teachers union. They're controlled by the most radical left part of their party. I mean, Schumer's case, he's scared to death that AOC will run against him in a primary. But the others, I don't get it. Mark Kelly, Arizona is still a Republican state. Cortez Masto is already behind in the polls. Hassan is behind in the polls. Warnock is behind in the polls. I mean, we have every reason to believe we can win those four states, plus we can win in Colorado. We've got a great candidate in the state of Washington. And there's a poll out that Murray, who's been there forever, the Democrat in the state of Washington, is only up 3 points with a generic Republican. And we've got a great Republican running there, Tiffany Smiley.
So, Ken, let's walk through each of these. Let's go to Arizona. The primary won't be until late, but Mark Kelly defined himself as radical, in contrast to his other state senator, Senator Sinema, also a Democrat who rejected the effort to undermine the Senate stability. Does Mark Kelly survive that lurch to the left?
No. mean, let's remember, this is still a Republican state, right? This is, and Mark Kelly promised he was a moderate. Now he votes 100% with Chuck Schumer. He does everything Chuck Schumer tells him to do. So we're going to get a great candidate out of the primary. We've got a lot of good people running. And so it'll be a tough race, but we're going to win there. If you just think about it, look at that generic ballot across the country. People are rejecting the Democrats. So our job is just to explain that Mark Kelly is actually a Democrat. He's not a moderate. He's not an independent. He's a far left, you know, Chuck Schumer Democrat. That's not going to play well in Arizona.
Let's talk now about Las Vegas and Nevada. John Ralston, who I like a lot. He used to be a reporter. He is now obviously an advocate and is cheerleading Cortez Masto and slagging on Adam Laxalt, who he has a vendetta against. He said yesterday online or the day before that Cortez Masto had dramatically outraised Adam Laxalt. I'm not sure what he means by dramatically outraised. What's the situation in Nevada?
It doesn't matter. I mean, the problem that Cortez Masto has is she's Chuck Schumer. So when you vote for Cortez Masto, you're voting for Chuck Schumer in Nevada. That's not what they want right now. Right now, we're already beating Cortez Masto. When you look at the public polls that are out there, a Republican is winning, and so there's no reason we shouldn't win in Nevada. Also, they're rejecting Cortez Masto, people are sick and tired of just go through it. I mean, she votes for an open border. She votes to close schools. She won't stand up to Biden on anything. She just, whatever Chuck Schumer says, yes, sir, that's how she votes.
Now, Senator Warnock went with President Biden to Atlanta to give now the infamous speech in which he compared you and me and everybody listening to this show and everyone who wants local control of elections to Bull Connor, George Wallace, and Jefferson Davis. He tried to apologize, but then doubled down in his press conference. Is Raphael Warnock underwater, and is Herschel Walker beating him in trial heats?
Absolutely. First off, let's remember, I think all those individuals they were talking about were Democrats. And Democrats are the ones that wanted to limit the vote of African Americans in this country. So Herschel Walker is already beating Warnock. We released a poll in December. Herschel's running a very good race. He still has a primary, but he's way ahead. So he's already ahead of Warnock. Warnock is sort of the Doug Jones of this cycle. Georgia is still going to go Republican. We have a governor's race. We have a Senate race, primary. We're going to do really well in Georgia. It's still a Republican state.
Take me up to New Hampshire. You wanted Governor Sununu. The president actually read Governor Sununu's comments. I don't know if that's going to be an issue in the campaign, but will you have a great candidate in New Hampshire, and is Senator Hassan looking weak?
So Hassan's already underwater. She's been running ads since September to try to move her numbers up. It's not working because she's voting 100% with Chuck Schumer. I mean, you don't elect Chuck Schumer and Chris Sununu in the same state. Just stop and think about it like that. So we've got General Don Bolduc already in the race. It looks like the state senator, Chuck Morris, is going to get in the race. The Londonderry Township manager, Kevin Smith, is looking at the race, and there's others. So we're going to have some people think it's a negative or primary slate, but what's going to happen is it's going to give us way more press. And Hassan's not going to get better. She's defined. It's very difficult for people where in as bad a shape as Hassan is in to change her numbers.
So my last question is about Colorado, because Michael Bennett, I didn't have him on my list of vulnerables, but Joe Biden is so bad. The numbers are so terrible for Democrats. And then Michael Bennett voted to undo the filibuster, which is radical. Do you have a candidate out there who can beat him?
Well, first off, if Cory Gardner was running this year, we would clearly win. Absolutely. We've got Eli Bremmer's in the race. Campagna's in the race. Looks like there might be some other people getting in the race. So I think we have a great, great opportunity. The Bennett has got a lackluster image. I mean, people don't even know who he is. He ran for president. People even don't know that. He voted the wrong way. I think we have every reason to believe we can win. When you go back and you look, I mean, look, any state that Biden won by less than 10 points is a battleground state now. That's how bad the Democrats are going. Just look at Virginia and look at New Jersey. In New Jersey, we almost won the governor's race and didn't spend any money. So we have every reason to believe. I was with Kevin McCarthy. The House is going to do a great job. They're going to take back the House. as they get those votes out, it's going to help us win Senate races.
Senator Rick Scott, it is always great to go over the map with you. Thank you for making time for me. Senator Rick Scott of Florida is leading the NRSC effort across the country, working harder than any man I know in D.C. Rick Scott. I mean, it's like 25 hours a day with the guy. Thank you, Senator. ReliefFactor.com. Maybe I should send Senator Scott some ReliefFactor.com. He is always working. He is always working. I have been with him at a number of events. I have talked with him. I've gone to dinner with him. Rick Scott never stops. I am amazed at his energy level. So maybe I'll get him some ReliefFactor.com. If you find yourself slowed down because of minor aches and pains or recurring nagging injuries, especially you people who are in the car early because you have long commutes, and I know some of you do. I know some of you are listeners to this show for 90 minutes a day in the morning live, sometimes 2 hours in California live, because you're going from somewhere to somewhere that just you have to drive till you qualify for a home loan, and then you have to make that drive every day, and I'm glad to be your partner in the car. But take a bag of Relief Factor along with you, and never forget to take it. Jim Geraghty, the indispensable, is next, America. Stay tuned.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
When you had the president in Atlanta saying to the crowd there that, you know, he didn't march in the shoes of the students that are marching today, but that he marched in the civil rights movement, and he remembers the first time he got arrested, when he never marched in any civil rights movement and has never been arrested.
I mean, can we even believe this? That he routinely says things that everyone knows are made up. Nobody calls him on it. Look, this is why you do your program, I do my program. We need to do our best to get the truth out. And we have to be clear, the president, he's plumb loco. I don't know what is going on. I guess I would say this. I'll bet that within his administration, there is very nasty fighting because they see what we see. I'm sure Kamala Harris despises the Biden gang, and the Biden gang despises her. They have to keep that quiet. But it's really something that I think they're going to consume their own.
The Democratic Party knows that they're in trouble. When you say that their staff sees what's going on and we all see it, we got to remember one other thing. Vladimir Putin, Premier Xi, the leader of North Korea, the leader of Iran, these people all see it too. And there is a message being sent globally that America is a laughingstock right now, that the bowl of mashed potatoes that serves as the president in the White House right now is nothing more than a suit.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Policy to be broadly supported by senators representing a broader cross-section of Americans. A guardrail, inevitably viewed as an obstacle by whoever holds the Senate majority, but which in reality ensures that millions of Americans represented by the minority party have a voice in the process.
Eliminate the filibuster. I mean, that's unbelievable. This is what I mean about unserious people. This is not a serious agenda. It's a diabolical agenda. Break the Senate rules so that we can jam through voting rights, wink, wink, and upend the election process forever so that we can cheat and steal elections forever.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. That music means Jim Geraghty, the indispensable. Geraghty, the indispensable, joins me from nationalreview.com. Good morning, James. How are you?
Hugh, it is really nice to hear my theme song again.
Isn't it great? It's back. Jim, I want to talk to you about fake news. Because in the last 2 days, there was a minor incursion by the Supreme Court into NPR 2 days ago, destroying NPR's credibility. And then Donald Trump, Robert O'Brien, Mike Pompeo, Rick Scott have all made minor incursions into many people's credibility who said there was a DeSantis-Trump feud, including President Trump last night when asked by Sean Hannity if he'd heard about the alleged rift between himself and DeSantis, said this, cut number 37.
Well, he is right. I get along great with Ron. Ron was very good on the Mueller hoax. He was right up front, along with Jim Jordan and all of the rest of them. They were fantastic. The Republicans really stuck together, and it was a great thing. And Ron was one of them. And Ron wanted to run, and I endorsed him, and that helped him greatly. And he went on, and he's done a really terrific job in Florida. And I think, you know, Ron has been very good. He's been a friend of mine for a long time. It's totally fake news. I think Ron said last week, he said it very publicly. He says,
all right, fake news. Now, I'll tell you, Jim, I got hammered yesterday by Maggie Haberman. Other friends of mine got hammered by other reporters who had floated this feud. And it's just nonsense. Why do they do this?
So, Hugh, no doubt you have seen that the ratings for the news in television and newspaper circulation and, you know, by the way, my traffic's doing fine. But other folks apparently have seen an enormous drop in their traffic from 2020 to 2021. And I suspect there's a couple of reasons for that. But, you know, 2020 was a pretty dramatic year in which people were tuning in to see, oh, God, am I going to die today kind of type news. But, you know, Donald Trump drove an enormous amount of attention to the news. And Donald Trump in semi-retirement or in seclusion or exiled to the Isle of Elbe, in Florida, you know, not having Donald Trump in the news is not good for certain people. I don't want to pick on Maggie Haberman specifically, but let's face it, like, she was one of the...
Oh, was she mad at me yesterday when I simply reported that her objecting to Robert O'Brien and others throwing water on this said, I remarked, it's Donald Rumsfeld's the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence theory that she was embracing.
Let's say, one of the places I check every morning is Mimeo Random, which basically just gathers the news and basically just takes a topic and tells you who's writing about it. It doesn't necessarily, and it uses links and who's linking to what and stuff like that. Almost every day, not every day, but almost every day, there's a January 6th commission is high up there. Now, is that a story? Sure, it's a news story. But we still got the Omicron pandemic going on. We still got Ukraine and Russia. The economy, inflation, supply chain, there's a lot of stuff going on, right? But there are people who became addicted to Trump news. If you can put Trump in a headline, they think they're going to get higher traffic. And, oh, by the way, I think, you know, there's clearly some evidence for that. The thing is, what's going on with Trump on any given day is not necessarily the most interesting, relevant, or important thing that's going on in the news. However, Republican infighting, oh, they love writing that story.
Trump addiction is real. Yeah. And Trump withdrawal is awful to behold.
Right, and because DeSantis has been one of the most, you could say controversial, but I just think also one of the most outspoken, one of the most news-generating governors in the country. And he's kind of replaced Trump as, you know, he's the anti-Fauci, right? He's the epitome of all that's wrong, right up there with, you know, Georgia is conducting human sacrifices, that infamous Atlantic headline written, you know. So people love to hate Ron DeSantis. I say people, I mean people on the left. People love to hate Donald Trump. So the idea of a DeSantis-Trump fight, you know, this is Godzilla versus Mothra in their mind, right? This is, you know, the greatest fight. You know, they want to see it. Right? So this is, you know, they're grabbing the popcorn. This is the best news they can possibly get.
But it's not true. And Nina Totenberg made up a Godzilla-Mothra between Sonia Sotomayor and Neil Gorsuch. How do they think they can get away with this stuff? The Supreme Court has never done what it did this week.
Hold on, Hugh. I've checked, and I know a lot of people want to hold her accountable, and a lot of people think there was a terrible mistake, but Hugh, you're a scholar of this. If you check the Constitution, it says there that Nina Totenberg has a lifetime appointment to be the NPR Supreme Court correspondent.
You're right about that. Well, let me ask you about the next target. Governor Glenn Youngkin has come out blazing. And I mean naming the diversity officer to be in charge of advocating for the unborn and telling school districts they have to embrace parental choice. He's not mandating parental choice. He's mandating that school districts allow parental choice. He's not mandating masks go away. Is Youngkin now their new shiny object to go and attack because he's come out of the gate so strong?
He could be. I think you'll see more of it on DeSantis and Trump, obviously, because, you know, Trump is the established brand name of, hey, you got to look at this. DeSantis is getting there. And also, you know, Florida is a big consequential state. I don't know if we'd still call it a swing state. I think it's turning pretty red.
It's not, you
know, the rumors he's running for president. Nobody thinks Glenn Youngkin's going to run for president in 2024. So it's like
you don't think so? You don't think so?
Youngkin? No. No, he's got a job to do. He's not going anywhere for 4 years.
Jim Geraghty. Let's revisit that, my friend. Follow him on Twitter at Jim Geraghty. Forget his Morning Jolt newsletter over at National Review. And stay put. The Hillsdale Dialogue, Henry V, is next. Larry Arnn, Stephen Smith on The Hugh Hewitt Show. It's Friday. Don't go anywhere. This is Hugh Hewitt for townhall.com. Buckle up for 2022. The year in politics is going to be rough. The midterm election year seems predestined to banish the Democratic majorities in both houses of Congress. The country senses infirmity in President Biden, and many worry that our adversaries in China, Russia, and Iran sense that opening too. The shadow campaign for the GOP nomination in 2024 opens now, with a clear frontrunner being former President Donald Trump. The ranks of the top tier among possible GOP presidential nominees in alphabetical order starts with two senators, Arkansas's Tom Cotton and Ted Cruz of Texas. Then we have the populist Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, the former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and South Carolina Senator Tim Scott. If the world grows even darker in the days to come, Cotton and Pompeo, two former soldiers, start with some advantages. It's possible one or more will run whether or not the former president does. My bet, with 3 years to go, is that Trump runs and runs hard. Buckle up. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
49% of Americans that were polled say they more identify, they sympathize more with Democrats than with Republicans. 40% Republicans, 49% Democrats. Let me say that again. 49% Democrats, 40% Republicans. That's 1 year ago. In the second quarter of 2021, Republicans were at 43% and Democrats did not move. They were still at 49%. That's probably because some Republicans might have been a little sour about January 6th or kind of what happened, how we lost the Georgia Senate runoffs and they were done. But they came back home and we saw that in a variety of different types of numbers.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
How 1 million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to Salem Now. Streaming on Salem Now.
We understand that a plane has crashed into...
The people who knocked these buildings down will hear all of us soon.
Biggest and most costly manhunt in U.S. history.
United States killed Osama bin Laden.
There are reports surfacing that Al-Qaeda has placed a $50,000 bounty on the heads of any U.S. Navy SEALs.
Nobody's going to survive that. There's nobody in that.
This is the single largest loss of life in Afghanistan in a single incident.
Most of them are U.S. Navy SEALs.
We discovered bullets in the bodies of the Navy SEALs. The military threw them away.
More likely than not, that supports a shootout on board.
Anybody out there, we have a fallen angel.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
So, what change do the Democrats want post January 6th? You have Pearl Harbor, World War II. You have 9/11. After, just so you know, for all the children out there, you know there was a time where you didn't have to go through TSA to fly in an airplane? 9/11 gave us the TSA. 9/11 gave us the Department of Homeland Security. 9/11 gave us the NSA. 9/11 gave us a domestic spy agency. 9/11 gave unprecedented funding to the CIA and to the FBI, might I add. 9/11 gave all of these assets to people that, quite honestly, never earned them, but under the suffering of 3,000 Americans that were killed on 9/11, whatever you need, let's just get it done. 2008 financial crisis passed Dodd-Frank, which only made the big banks stronger. 2008 financial crisis was a mandate for whatever reason. Let's reorganize the American healthcare system. We got Obamacare, hand out to big insurance companies and big pharmaceutical companies and big hospital lobbies. Chinese coronavirus, hand out to Pfizer, Moderna, AstraZeneca, not to mention the tech companies. The tech companies were massive beneficiaries of the Chinese coronavirus. People staying at home, staring at their screens all day long. Stock prices of tech companies have never been higher. And so Kamala Harris and Joe Biden are saying this is comparable to January 6th is comparable to Pearl Harbor and 9/11. I want you to think about that, because from their perspective, they're not wrong. In reality, they're wrong. But I'm going to tell you what they mean when they say that.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
Our despicable president, I've never used the term with regard to a president in my long career. Joe Biden's a despicable human being. And he's not only the worst president, he's the worst man to serve as president. He's a bad human being, in my opinion. And dagger at democracy, dagger at the throat of democracy. I wonder who wrote that for him. What left-wing hack. This is exactly what the left has always done, just as the fascists on the right have done, and the Nazis did. That is, you accuse your enemies of what you're doing. It's a smokescreen. It's not projection. That it is as well, but it's not primarily projection. It's a smokescreen. I can ruin this country while charging my enemies with ruining the country. That is what you do. Who is suppressing free speech, the most important freedom of all? The left or the right, Joe Biden? Who has created a hatred of tens of millions of Americans like you have toward the unvaccinated? Is there a precedent for the way you have described vast numbers of Americans who in good conscience have not had a have not been vaccinated? It's not even a vaccine, by the way. You know that the dictionaries have changed the definition. CDC changed it. I read it for you earlier this week. It is no longer, for all of vaccination history, it prevented you getting the illness. Now I think it's changed to protect.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Absurdity of yesterday, nothing does. If that doesn't, if that's not, that's in poker, I think it's called the tell, right? That's the reveal. Yeah, this is sort of a joke. We're kind of playing a game here. We don't really mean it. We want to stop Trump from running again in 2024. We know the only person who was killed as a result of the actions of anybody on January 6th was Ashley Babbitt. And you know what? Let's have Broadway singers perform for us. I mean, you cannot write a Hollywood script that would be any more laughable than this.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
The Hillsdale Dialogue is underway, the last radio hour of the week, which is always on the Hugh Hewitt Show. Something important, something lasting, something that endures. Being with Dr. Larry Arnn, president of Hillsdale College, and Dean Stephen Smith, professor of English at Hillsdale, talking about Shakespeare has been grand fun for me, and it will continue for many more weeks. You've got to go back to the iTunes page of the Hillsdale Dialogue. Just type in iTunes and Hillsdale Dialogues, and you'll get them all. Or go to hillsdale.edu and search around. You'll find them there as well. Last week, we didn't quite finish up Henry IV, Part 2. And we need to, Stephen Smith, because it's a bridge to Henry V. What happened at the end that we need to know about?
Oh, just super briefly, two important things. Hal is crowned king, and then he is going to publicly accept the Chief Justice as his kind of new father figure. He calls him a father unto my youth. To make a long story short, he and the justice had had trouble in the past. He had even struck this guy. And now you can kind of see he's the monarch, and he doesn't want to be seen as against justice. So he accepts that guy as his new father. And then probably the most important human detail, the play ends with King Henry V, now Hal, seeing Falstaff during his procession and banishing him. So he says, I know thee not, old man. I have long dreamt of such a kind of man as you, but being awake, I do despise my dream. Make your body less and your grace more. That's a funny way to put it.
Yeah.
I banish you as I have done the rest of my misleaders. Come not near my person by 10 miles. If you reform yourself, we'll talk. If not, nope. And he leaves. Falstaff thinks he's just joking around. He doesn't really mean it. He had to say that. But of course, Falstaff's heart is actually broken by this scene. And Henry IV, Part 2 ends with the news that a little bird has already filled the ears of one man with the news that war with France is imminent. And then we're at Henry V.
And that little bird pleased the king?
Yes. The music of the bird pleased the king. So what has Hal done? Very quickly, even just as quickly as he put that crown on his head, he took his father's dying advice. War with France is going to happen.
So now we're in Henry V. Before we do that, let's go back for the benefit of the Steelers fans and new listeners to the Hugh Hewitt Show and review how we got here, the three plays that got us here. Because Henry V may be the most watched play. Do you agree with me on that because of Branagh's movie?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it has so many good film versions. There's a Laurence Olivier. There's a Branagh. There's the new Hollow Crown that Dr. Arnn mentioned last time. So a lot of film versions of this. It starts with Richard II, and Richard is deposed and then murdered. The middle two plays are Henry IV, 1 and 2, and they feature Henry IV ruling England, but with all sorts of turbulence and storms and violence. Henry IV, who ends with his death, Hal becomes king, takes the justice as his new father figure, banishes Falstaff, and gets ready to invade France.
Now, Dr. Arnn, will you remind me, my history of the English-speaking people is on the East, but I think Churchill held Henry IV in high regard.
Oh, yeah. Well, both these Henrys, who have, you know, there's a mixed record in Shakespeare of these two, but they were both successful, very. And you know, Henry V is more interesting. Churchill's opinion of Henry V is more interesting than of Henry IV because he glories in Henry V, and he thinks Britain should have got out of France a long time before. And that's a strategic question, right? Churchill sees, Shakespeare significantly sees, British history is attempting to build an island power without enemies on its border, and that meant they couldn't rule France. And I'll tell a quick story. My mother-in-law, a great woman who was an Air Force plotter in the Second World War, I took her to see the Kenneth Branagh when it first came out. She was in America with Penny and me. And at the end, when the chorus, Steve's going to tell you about the choruses, but the chorus relates at the very end that this conquest of France didn't last very long. And my mother-in-law, sitting beside me, groaned to herself. and I thought, because I've read Churchill, right, and Shakespeare, and I thought, no, it was never meant to rule France. But the greatness of her country was important to her. And that shows that those emotions live down through generations.
Very deep, very deep. So tell us about the chorus, Stephen Smith.
Well, this play is each of the plays has its own character. So Richard II is all in poetry. The Henry IV plays are a mixture of prose and verse. And when you get to Henry V, you actually have this chorus that guides your experience of the play and kind of fires you up from beginning to end. In the Branagh film, I believe it's Derek Jacobi, I may be misremembering that, but he really integrates the chorus into the film very effectively. And so it's sort of the thrilling, you know, apparently pro-Hal voice, but it's like everything in Shakespeare, a little more subtle than that. So the chorus is begins with, "Oh, for a muse of fire!" exclamation point. Wow, it's that kind of voice.
But the chorus calls him Caesar, Alexander, Mercury. Your notes said that. I'm not sure these are all great things for a king of England to be called.
Well, welcome to Shakespeare, right? So this is how he rolls as an artist. You have Hal. We're supposed to judge Hal, right? And then we have him compared to all of these figures. Just take three of them. A conquering Caesar, another Alexander, or the mirror of all Christian kings. And if you teach students and you just wait for a moment after pointing that out, raise his or her hand and say, well, which is it?
Which is it? You can't be those three things. So that's pretty good. Let's make sure we get to the tennis balls, all right? Because I think this is amusing.
Yeah, well, I mean, when we begin the play, two churchmen are speaking. And these opening scenes are very important for the whole play, even though sometimes they're cut. The churchmen wonder over Hal's transformation, as we all have been. They mention there's a bill in Parliament against the church. They've been talking to the king, and they've decided to make the king a big offer of cash, and the king is considering it. And this is in the background of the opening scene. That when Henry enters, he wants to know from the church, may I with right and conscience make this claim to the throne of France? May I go invade France and take what's rightfully mine? And after a long and kind of somewhat torturous explanation, the answer is yes, sir, you can. And Hal kind of reveals his next plot in the play, which is to rise like the sun over France and become the king of France. So that's Hal. We're used to him at this point. But unfortunately for the French, they decide to insult the young king by sending him tennis balls, my liege, because he's a young guy, he's vain. Here, go play with some tennis balls.
Is there any explanation for a needless provocation?
Yeah. they're just trying to insult, they're showing that they have slight regard for him. And they're not worried about him as a king or as a leader, and boy, does it backfire, because Hal revs the engines again. Those tennis balls set him off, and he says he's going to play such a match of tennis in France that the whole country is going to mourn over it. And then he says, I'm going to rouse me in my throne of France. And so he is ticked off. He's fired up, and war is upon England and France.
And again, this is occurring during Elizabeth's reign, which is a reign of constant threat and war, if I correctly remember. I don't know what year this comes out or what's going on, but I imagine an English audience likes that.
Oh, yeah. My favorite production of this is Kenneth Branagh for two reasons. One is it shows the squalor of the war, the difficulty of the English living in disease and bad weather in France. And the other is this particular scene. Steve, by the way, has absorbed so much Shakespeare that he's quoting it automatically.
Yes.
He said, slight regard.
Yes. Right?
Well, when the herald, who's played in this really great production by Brian Blessed, comes in this shining silver armor to confront the king of France, who's played by Paul Scofield, who's really great, played Thomas More, and he lectures him, and we got to go, don't we?
Yeah, we do. Come back. We'll get it when we come back. Don't go anywhere, America. The Hillsdale Dialogue rolls along. Don't go anywhere.
Powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it. We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
But he knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified, I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified, you can't see it.
Collusion, you just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
You really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not going to accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're fighting Russian spies and Nazis.
Russiagate has been the most egregious abuse of everything that was supposed to have been good about our government.
The thing that they were investigating the Trump campaign for is what they themselves were doing.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Dates that occupy not only a place on our calendars, but a place in our collective memory. December 7th, 1941. September 11th, 2001. And January 6th, 2021.
Lives at risk. The nation's capital under siege.
This wasn't a group of tourists. This was an armed insurrection. They weren't looking to uphold the will.
Quick question. If it's an armed insurrection, how come not one of the 700 people arrested have been charged with insurrection?
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
The Pilgrims, hailed by Movie Guide as inspiring. Find out what everyone is talking about. Watch this new documentary to see God's providence in the lives of the Pilgrims.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. The Hillsdale Dialogue is underway. All things Hillsdale are collected at hillsdale.edu. All of the dialogues are at the iTunes page that collects them. Just Google Hillsdale Dialogue or hugh4hillsdale.com. Dr. Arnn, when we went to break, you were talking about...
So this herald comes in to the King of France, and the Dauphin is there, right? And he's this cocky boy. And the King of France says, what do you want? He says, what does Henry want? And he says, he's coming for your throne and your kingdom. And if you hide it in your heart, there he will rake for it. He says, he comes in thunder and earthquake like a Jove. But if requiring fail, he will compel. See, it's a very powerful thing. And then he says, the king says, anything else? And the herald says, no, unless my Lord Dauphin is here. And then the Dauphin says, I stand here for the Dauphin. And then he says, scorn, what have you for the Dauphin? And the herald says, scorn and defiance, slight regard, contempt. And anything, it's just awesome, right?
Scorn and defiance, light. I got to go memorize that because I can use that with callers. So Stephen Smith, I love in your outline, he's taken the East Cheapers with him, which is a small lesson, a large lesson. The large lesson is you can't leave your past behind when you're going to rule. Your political past is going to come with you. But Falstaff kicks the bucket. That's sad.
Yeah, Falstaff. Shakespeare had promised that he would depict Falstaff in this play, but actually he dies off stage, and his death is just related to us. We're told he cries out against sack, against wine, and against women. So he dies repentant, and nobody wants him to die because very funny, and one of the best jokes of Falstaff is his last one. He's asked, you know, be of good cheer, Sir John. Don't talk of dying. Be of good cheer. And he responds, God, 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 three or four times. And then he dies. Oh. So that is in the play, and it's, for many readers, one of the most emotionally powerful speeches in the play is the death of Falstaff. Now, in the East Cheapers, they're going to follow Hal to war, but this whole plot line brings up a big issue in the Henriad, which is what effect does a leader have on his followers? And they follow him. They shared, you know, life together in East Cheap, misadventures and all this stuff that was going on down there. And when they go to France, they do not conduct themselves as Hal does. And Hal conducts himself as the king. They kind of do their old thing, which includes theft, things like that. And indeed, one of them is hung. So it's a difficulty that Shakespeare is showing. He's wondering, are these people better for having been with Hal? How much are they responsible for their own character, their own decisions? It's a really important part of the play. I had a great paper out in D.C. on this, and the student wrote that Hal can do things in the play that these other characters simply can't do. Like, he can hang out in East Cheap. He can rise like the sun and triumph. But other people, they can't do what Hal can do. And they're actually not helped by his leadership.
Well, on St. Crispin's Day, though, they get to recall. Don't the old men get to recall? Isn't that what every veteran gets to do?
Well, that's the thing. So there's not East Chief, they're not the only people in Hal's army. They're the kind of ordinary part of his army. Then there are the other leaders. And so the play just has this double quality, right? Where you have an attractive, positive teaching, and then you have a sort of troubling teaching as well.
Fetching Mrs. Hewitt went on a carrier for a visit, the old salt chief told her that the young sailors complain bitterly every day of their service, and then when they're old men, they'll say it's the best years of their life. I passed that along. I think they do get something out of it. We will come back to that in a second. Henry V is on the table for the Hillsdale Dialogue. Dr. Arnn, Dean Smith will be right back. Don't go anywhere. It's the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Was a genius. His most amazing discoveries thought to be written in a lost journal. Now in the right hands, it could revolutionize the 21st century, but in the wrong hands.
Kill him. John.
If you can stop an earthquake, doesn't that mean you could start one too?
That's why that notebook should never fall into the wrong hands.
There's an old brown battered notebook in my office at work. You have to find it, take it, and keep it hidden at all costs. The G20 leaders meeting downtown, they're in danger. In fact, the whole of downtown could be in danger.
If we are to build a superhuman, we must first eliminate those who are flawed.
People are created equally. All of downtown, the high-rises were built on rollers to withstand horizontal shakes. A vertical quake this size could collapse half of downtown.
We have commenced the countdown.
Shall we stop this thing?
Save the universe!
Catalysts create change. When you have moments that all of a sudden you remember where you were, typically those moments mean something big is coming after that. So there's only a couple moments like that that define a generation. For my parents' generation, it's where were you when Kennedy was shot? My parents could tell you. 9/11, I remember exactly where I was. I was in a second grade classroom at Quest Academy in Palatine, Illinois. I remember where I was when the 2008 financial crisis was unfolding. Gulf of Tonkin was an event, highly suspicious, I want to say, was an event that led to the official declaration of the United States getting involved in the Vietnam War. World War I, the assassination of Franz Ferdinand, who was the presumptive heir to the throne of the Austrian-Hungary Empire. He died in Sarajevo, Bosnia, and everything else unfolded from there. One of the messiest catastrophic wars in human history. So you look through these dates, and then you see what comes next. When you have those moments, it creates a mandate for rulers to dramatically change things. And January 6th was no different. Now, I am by no means saying that what happened on January 6th is anywhere in the orbit of the catastrophe of World War I, World War II. However, That is what Kamala Harris and Biden are saying.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
According to Kamala Harris, it's right up there with 9/11. I remember what I was doing on the morning of September 11th. I was in the Empire State Building here in New York City being evacuated. I remember a lot of historic days. I remember where I was when Ronald Reagan was shot. I remember when the Challenger blew up. I don't remember really what I was doing last year. I'm working, I'm sure. We're never going to forget 2020, 2021, now 2022, and now more bad economic news in Biden's America.
Breaking now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The U.S. added only 199,000 jobs in the month of December, falling well short of expectations as employers battle all the workplace disruptions going on with lockdowns, mandates, Omicron. There's a little bit of good news. The unemployment rate dropped from 4.2% to 3.9%, but economists had expected the economy to add 422,000 jobs in December. According to Dow Jones, the number, 199,000. Let's go, Brandon. 23 past the hour. Our number is 800-655-MIKE. 800-655-6453. And man, the scoundrels. Chuck Todd is one of the worst of the worst. I swear, you hear anybody say, oh yeah, Chuck Todd's a great guy and he's my buddy. You ought to run. You ought to be very wary of anybody who counts this guy, this hack, as an honorable journalist. Because he's not. He's a hack.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
You called your son. You personally promised him you would be here.
Prayer is a powerful thing, Ethan. It really does work, if you believe.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
The Hillsdale Dialogue last radio hour of the week is underway. All things Hillsdale. Go over to hillsdale.edu. Sign up for, Stephen Smith has taught a couple of great courses, video courses. Dr. Arnn has taught many of the great, brilliant minds at Hillsdale are at work 24/7 at your beck and call at hillsdale.edu. Dr. Arnn, I remember from the History of the English-Speaking People, the Agincourt description. I think I probably read it 100 times. I make my law students read much of that book. And something I'm thinking about proposing to you is actually having our audience read it with us in a series of conversations, because it does provide a grounding in how we got here to this moment, how the American experience happened. And I was just rereading his short chapter on the American Constitution, which is a better 12 pages than anyone in D.C. currently has a grasp of, other than perhaps Supreme Court justices. But I digress. This is the two battles segment. And so we got to get into those two battles. I don't know how they staged this. It must be amazing, Stephen Smith, to see it performed live. I have not.
Well, I think this is where film just has such a huge advantage.
Yes.
I mean, you know, the chorus calls attention to the outrage of trying to represent something like a great battle on the little stage. And so the chorus is well aware that it could strike someone as ridiculous think, oh, this is Agincourt, or this is, these are like five guys with swords. We've all seen this right in the theater. What are you going to do? It's a stage. It's live. Yeah. Are you supposed to have thousands of troops on stage? So the chorus is aware of this. And that's where I think film is really just awesome. I mean, I love.
Well, to imagine Agincourt, as Churchill describes it, is to imagine a sudden, decisive, overwhelming victory by Longbow. It's just hard to believe the route so quick and so final.
Yeah. Yeah. By the way, imagine a major battle on a small stage. That's what poetry does. And so even just Shakespeare's words recall that battle. I mean, you know, just reading it on a page, taking up, you know, 6 inches of space. And so everything is a microcosm, right? And so, yeah, and sure enough, in the play, I mean, in my opinion is you judge Shakespeare plays by their faithfulness. And the faithfulness means, first, saying the words, and second, acting as the people would act while saying the words. And the best, Henry V, have the advantage over a stage play that you can have thousands of troops, but they have, well, they don't really actually have thousands, they have hundreds. But against that, in the end, it's good if it's like it was.
I
think the Kenneth Branagh one is just awesome, the way they staged that.
Did you, by the way, have your family in England commented on Dunkirk, the movie?
The ones who, my father-in-law, who was there until the last day, he was dead. And I haven't talked to my wife's siblings about it, but I resent one thing about it very much, and that is, first of all, there are photographs of the beach. The beach was crowded. It was not a single line of people, right, three or four different places. And second of all, my father-in-law was attached to the Coldstream Guards, which is one of the five Guards regiments. He was a colonel in the Territorial Army, as his father before him. And the reason he had such a hard war, you know, because he was the last day of leaving Dunkirk, and then he was a POW of Japan for 3.5 years, is because he went everywhere with the Coldstream Guards. Well, he reports that they would get up every morning and drill. In other words, it was just like they were in the barracks in wartime. And that means they weren't. There wasn't anybody.
Drifting around disorganized and somber.
Right, not knowing what's what, right?
Yeah.
They kept themselves in order, and that's one reason they got away, so many of them.
The disadvantage of film. There's an advantage that you can be epic, but you can also be epically wrong in the portrayal of something. I think the World War One movies are that way. Back to Henry V, though. People are waiting for the MacGuffin, the payoff, Stephen Smith, the great lines.
Well, I mean, we get them all in this part of the play. I mean, at the first siege, you know, we hear "Once more unto the breach, dear friends, once more," Henry's great speech. And then in that siege, he also has another speech that he gives to the mayor of the town demanding surrender. And this is Harfleur. You know, this is a moment where Hal's rhetorical firepower is again on complete display. In the first speech, he rouses the troops to fight, and in the second speech, he threatens the mayor with utter destruction if he doesn't surrender. And these are like that double quality I've been mentioning. Hal's rousing speech is, he tells his men, you need to imitate the action of the tiger and not fight to the death. And then in the second speech, he threatens the mayor by saying, you know, if you don't yield, you're going to be guilty in defense, and I can't be held responsible for what my troops will do. They're going to rape. They're going to pillage. They're going to mow down with liberty and conscience wide as hell.
Well, this is why when the chorus said Caesar, Alexander, Mercury, and the mirror of every Christian king, I'm thinking, well, this is very Caesar-like. He repeatedly warned people, we will destroy everyone in the city and cut off the hands of everybody who raises an arm against us, and he did. And so this is that part of him, and he's Mercury-like, he's moving fast, but this is not the mirror of every Christian king.
Well, this is the thing, right? What's the truth? Is Hal a Caesar, or is Hal a Christian king? Is Hal a legitimate ruler? Is Hal a tyrant? That even comes up in Henry V. He says, we are no tyrant, we are a Christian king. So this is what he wants us to wonder over, and it's not so much raining on the parade of the play to bring up the double quality. It's really to do justice to the work. It's rousing, it's fiery, it's incredible rhetoric, and yet it has these undercurrents as well. And so what do you think about Hal's leadership? Is this good rhetoric? Is this necessary rhetoric? Is this iffy rhetoric? And then that line to the mayor, you're going to be guilty in defense. One of the most interesting things Hal does in Henry V, one of his key moves, he has a way of making other people either be responsible for his decisions as a leader or share responsibility. So the churchmen at the beginning who say, yes, you can invade France. Okay, so they're part of it. The mayor, he'll be the cause of rape and pillage, not the troops. It's his fault. And so these questions keep coming up, and it's one of Hal's key moves as a leader is to make these other people share the responsibility or be the responsible party for what happens next.
He goes out in secret. We mentioned this last week to hear what the troops are saying. And what does he learn from that? From Bates, whom everyone's going to think is this is where the name came in Downton Abbey, must have come from this, Bates and Williams.
He says to his friends, the other lords, you know, I in my bosom must debate a while. And then he kind of, I want to be alone, he tells them the night before. And then rather than being alone, he puts the cloak on and then goes off to see how the troops are doing. And this is a really remarkable sequence in the whole Henry ad. He runs into Bates and Williams, and Henry defends the king. He says, the king's cause is just, it's honorable. And one of the ordinary guys says, well, that's more than we know. And he says, we're going to die tomorrow, and the king will probably get ransomed, and he'll go back to England. It'll be fine. But as for us, we're toast.
We're toast.
So there's a critique of Henry that comes out of this exchange, especially from this guy Williams. And what Williams is preoccupied with is the fundamental question, is this just or not? He says, if it's just, fine. If this war is not just, then the king, he says, is going to have a heavy reckoning to make on doomsday, when all of the severed limbs and all the butchered bodies and all of the muck of war, when it all comes up and says, you led us to France for no good reason, with no justice. And so Hal gets mad at this one and defends himself and says, Williams is wrong. Every soldier is responsible for himself. It's very complicated scene.
But then he ends with a prayer. It's very interesting. Yeah. I think maybe the Williams got to him. And here's the Christian king as opposed to Caesar, Mercury, and Alexander.
Well, I don't know who pointed this out first, but Williams is also William S. Right? William Shakespeare.
Oh.
Here, who knows? The guy's full of jokes. But anyways, the prayer ends, prayer ends the scene. He prays to the god of battles to steal his soldier's heart, to possess them not with fear. But then most interestingly, Hugh, guess what he brings up in the prayer right before Agincourt? My father. And what happened, how he got the crown. Now, at the end of Henry IV, part two, he said, I don't care. You got it. It's your crown. It's my crown. It's fine. But here in this prayer, he says, not today, O Lord, not today. Think upon the fault my father made.
Well, sure. That makes sense, right? Don't visit justice on me today.
But see, what was funny though is with Shakespeare, Hugh, you gotta put things side by side in your judgment. So he says this right here, but back at the end of Henry IV, part two, what he said is, Father, no more about this. You took the crown by bad means. Stop. It's your crown. You gave it to me. It's legit. Flash forward to Agincourt. Not quite so clear. And now Hal's saying, oh dear God, not today, not today. Well, powerful.
Remember the plot, right? So Richard II provokes Hal's father, right? He seizes all his property. He exiles him. It's really stupid what Richard II does. And so there isn't much doubt that in the beginning he has a just cause. But by the end, all of the people, all of the nobles who rallied to help him are turning against him, and he kills some of them, right? So it doesn't go well, and Hotspur is the son of one of the people who made Henry IV king, and so when you get to messing around with power, and when the lines of legitimacy are unclear, right? that's going on in American politics today.
You betcha it is. Don't go anywhere, America. The final scene coming up. We'll be right back on the Hillsdale Dialogue. And don't forget your relieffactor.com for the weekend. There it is, the relieffactor.com. When you take it, you will feel better about yourself and the day ahead. You will feel great. And if you take it every day, you'll feel great every day, or at least better than you otherwise would have felt. Doesn't do anything for illness. It just works on those inflammation spots around your body to reduce the inflammation that occurs with exercise and aging. It just makes you move better. So if you're going to go to the gym today, take Relief Factor before or after. If you're going to go out and do a run or a walk or a swim, take ReliefFactor.com. If you're going to live today, take ReliefFactor.com. It's all you need to get through the day. I carry in Kirkham and Resveratrol and Omega. $19.95 gets you started, and you'll be happy that you did. ReliefFactor.com. Come back for the last segment of the Hillsdale Dialogue right here on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Streaming on Salem Now.
We understand that a plane has crashed into
the people who knocked these buildings down will hear all of us soon.
Biggest and most costly manhunt in U.S. history.
United States killed Osama bin Laden.
There are reports surfacing that Al-Qaeda has placed a $50,000 bounty on the heads of any U.S. Navy SEALs.
Nobody's going to survive that. There's nobody in that.
This is the single largest loss of life in Afghanistan in a single incident.
Most of them are U.S. Navy SEALs.
We discovered bullets in the bodies of the Navy SEALs. The military threw them away.
More likely than not, that supports a shootout on board.
Get everybody out there. We have a fallen angel.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Well, my colleague Jake Tapper, Mr. Biden, has gone and looked at the tape, and Donald Trump was specifically referring to people that feel that the Confederate monument ought to remain in public square. In fact, he specifically said, quote, and I'm not talking about the neo-Nazis and the white nationalists because they should be condemned totally, end of quote. Nobody says anything. But Donald Trump is pushing the big lie. And we talked about 2016. We talked about the fact that two-thirds of Democrats falsely believe that the Russians changed vote tallies when the 1,000-page Senate report, I didn't read all of it, I'm waiting for them to make it into a movie, but I read enough of it, reached two major conclusions. Let's do this again. Conclusion number one. Oh, they tried. They tried mightily, did the Russians. But they failed to change a single vote tally. YouGov poll, respected, 66% of Democrats believe the Russians changed vote tallies in 2016. And the Senate report could reach no conclusion one way or the other whether or not the Russian interference altered the outcome of the election. In fact, Jay Johnson, Obama's Secretary of Homeland Security, said, I'd have to be a mind reader to know that. We don't know. 78% of Democrats, according to Gallup, respected poll, probably the most respected poll in the country, 78% of Democrats believe the Russian interference, quote, altered the outcome of the election, end of quote.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
The Pilgrims, hailed by Movie Guide as inspiring. Find out what everyone is talking about. Watch this new documentary to see God's providence in the lives of the Pilgrims.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is the 5 quarts in 1 gallon of radio time, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, Dr. Arnn, president of Hillsdale College. Dean Stephen Smith is with me. We're at the final phases of Henry V, Shakespeare's great, great play. The Band of Brothers speeches, of course, maybe the best bit of Shakespeare known in America, do you think? Caesar's death oration by Anthony, but it's got to be this one.
Well, I think it's probably the most memorized, well, among the most memorized of all of Shakespeare. And it's Hal at his rhetorical most powerful moment in the play. And he addresses both the leadership and the ordinary people. He even goes so far as to say, if you shed your blood with me today, you'll be my brother, no matter how vile you were before this. And he says, when we get back to England later in life, in the latter day, you're going to look back on these scars and say, thank God I fought with Harry on St. Christmas Day. So it's a very powerful speech. But notice something, Hugh. Hal directs the attention there to the latter day, back in England, showing the scars, enjoying the glory, remembering the camaraderie. What did Williams do the night before? He wanted to talk about the latter day, too. But his latter day was doomsday. It was judgment day. Whoa, the play's startling the way it's made. And so Hal unifies everyone, and they're going to fight and win.
Let me ask you about the murder of the French prisoners, because when I was reading a biography of Napoleon recently, he executed 3,000 prisoners at Gaza early in his tyranny. And you really don't, you don't execute prisoners. It's always morally ambiguous in Saving Private Ryan, and every depiction of it in The Great Escape. Everyone recoils from the execution of prisoners. So what's it tell us about Henry V?
Well, it tells us a lot about him and about how Shakespeare makes something in a frustrating way, but in a greatly provocative way. First, let me throw something out there. I'm an admirer of the Kenneth Branagh film, too, as well. But did you notice anything about his depiction of the battle scenes?
I do not remember.
He leaves out the prince. Slaughter of the French prisoners.
Oh, that's why we don't remember it. Okay.
Yeah, whoops. You know, hold on. I kind of cut that one out of there.
Oh, wow. What a choice.
Now, I think, okay, hold on. It's treated in some sense. However, not in the way Shakespeare presents it. So in the play, it's very confusing, and I always read this out loud with students and let them be confused, because the first thing Shakespeare shows us is Henry hearing an alarm and thinking that it means the French have got reinforcements. And then he gives the order, kill the prisoners. So that's version one. The scene clears, two other leaders come onto the stage, and they say, do you hear what the French did? Therefore, the king has most worthily ordered that the prisoners be killed. The second version
is war crimes defense.
Yeah, exactly. And he does not resolve this. He just puts it there. That's how he does it. Bam. Well, which is it? What did Henry, you know, in the notes I mentioned, you know, there are different ways to look at it. Is Henry simply, this is a war, and he thinks, oh my goodness, we're going to lose. I got to do anything I can to win. Or is the second view correct, that there was more to the decision, that it's justifiable? But Shakespeare just throws it out there, and that's one of the last decisions we see from Hal in the play.
What do you think about that, Dr. Arnn? Mm-hmm.
What do you think? Well, you have to contrast that. In the Kenneth Branagh play, he plays up very much the French breaking into the back and murdering the boys who are guarding the baggage. You see?
Well, that's the rationale, yes.
Yeah, Branagh is partisan about
yes, that. Yes, he is.
In a way that Shakespeare is not.
Yes, it's a war cry. I think Churchill bemoans it. I don't have the book in front of me. I think he bemoans it. I can't recall.
Yeah, I can't recall either.
Doctor, you're exactly right. That second version invokes the boys and the treatment of the luggage, and that's the reason for Henry giving the order. but we just saw.
Yeah, so we got 3 minutes, Stephen Smith. We got to do Catherine. We got 1 minute. Catherine and Hal, the ideal leader.
We got a lot of trouble on our hands then, Hugh. The play is going to end. So England wins. Hal directs all the glory to God. And then the negotiations take up the rest of the play. Hal is going to demand Catherine as his bride, as his queen. But he will woo her in a famous scene. And Catherine is a fascinating figure. She knows that the tongues of men are full of deceits. And she doesn't want Henry to kiss her because it's against the custom of France. And Henry basically tells her, don't you know that kings and queens can do anything they want to do? And so he's going to end the play getting married to her and with peace negotiations that are successful. Now, all that said, the play ends with a last chorus. And rather than that rousing chorus we got throughout the play, we now have a sonnet, and it laments the early death of Henry V and the return of war and civil action.
All for naught. But we will talk next week about the next play, and we'll come back to this, because it's not always not for naught. Dr. Larry Arnn, president of Hillsdale College, Dean Stephen Smith of Hillsdale. Everything Hillsdale at hillsdale.edu. Thank you. Marvelous hour. I'll talk to you on Monday, America, on the next Hugh Hewitt Show.